Dear students, Assalamu Alaikum. This is the seventh lecture of numerical analysis. And this lecture is related to the cubic spline interpolation. You saw in this chapter from the start, we are seeing that we are approximating the data by a curve, and then whatever the requirement of our problem or project is, we study the problem accordingly, we do the interpolation. The techniques we did so far was the polynomial approximation, and normally the drawback of polynomial approximation is severe oscillations near the boundaries. So the people, the researchers are trying to increase the accuracy and looking for different techniques. So cubic spline interpolation technique, this has been introduced again for the same purpose, to replace the data by a smooth and continuous curve and then study nature of the data. What are the requirements of the project you are working on, and then you have to study accordingly. What are your requirements? Look for the requirements. Spline interpolation claims that we are getting good results near the boundaries also. Remember, this is very important technique. It's normally using for the solution of the differential equations as well as the partial differential equations. And you will see in the literature that a huge literature is available on the splines using for the solution of the ODEs and PDEs. And you will notice that it gives very good accuracy. So I will say that this is very important, particularly for your future career also. So let's try to understand what the splines are. Let's assume we have an interval AB, and as usual we do the partition of this interval in this form. We divide this complete interval into sub-intervals such that A is equal to x0, less than x1, less than x2, so on, less than xn, and this is equal to B. So you can see that we have divided this interval into sub-intervals. The sub-intervals are from x0 to x1, then from x1 to x2, then from x2 to x3, and so on. Finally, from xn minus 1 to xn, where xn is equal to b. This is the endpoint of this interval. In other words, I can say that we are having how many sub-intervals? We are having n plus 1 number of points, so n number of sub-intervals are there. So we divided the interval AB into n number of sub-intervals. Further, we assume that, let's assume f is a function which is defined on the interval AB, which we discussed right now. And let's assume we are having the data points x0 f of x0, x1 f of x1, up to xn f of xn. So you can see that there are n plus 1 number of data points. And the target is to replace this set of data points by a smooth and continuous curve. For this purpose, what we are doing, we are introducing the splines. How we are introducing the splines? Splines, normally we are representing this by S of X. This is just a matter of notation. And this is the approximation of the function F of X, where X is coming from this interval. So spline interpolant, these are piecewise polynomial functions on a subinterval. So I will say this is between two consecutive points of your data. Normally this is the notation we are representing, but again I am telling you this is totally up to you, whatever the notation you are using. And they will satisfy certain conditions of continuity. You will see what kind of conditions there will be. So what we are doing, we are defining one spline between these two points, x0, f of x0, x1, f of x1. And second spline we define between these two points, x1, f of x1, and x2, f of x2. And we continue this, finally, we define another spline, the last spline between xn minus 1, f of xn minus 1, and xn, f of xn. So you can see that there are n plus 1 number of data points, and we are defining n number of splines. One spline between the two consecutive data points. There are different kind of splines. The first one is the linear spline. How we are defining the linear spline? The linear spline is defined by S j of x is equal to aj plus bj into x minus xj. This is between the two consecutive points, and the consecutive points are xa and xj plus 1. So you can see that I am using x minus initial point of this subinterval. As I told you before, there are n plus 1 number of points. The spline between this point and this point we are representing by S0, the value of j is equal to 0. The spline between this point and this point is denoted by S1. And similarly, the spline between x2 and x3 is defined by S3 and so on. So in this way, I can say that the value of j is starting from 0 and reaches up to n minus 1. If you look at this expression, this is a linear expression. The power of x is highest power of x is 1. That's the reason it is called a linear spline. F. There is a student of modeling processes. So in that case, they are defining the spline as SGX is equal to AJ plus BJ into X. So the idea is the same. If I simplify this, I will get some constant plus another constant multiplied by X. But normally this helps us in calculating the values of these constants. In this case, AJ and BJ, they are constants to be determined. So if the value of J starting from 0 reaches up to n minus 1, so it means that there are A0, A1, A2, up to AN minus 1, n number of constants. Similarly, B0, B1, B2, up to Bn minus 1. Again, n number of constants. So if you look at this linear spline, there are 2n number of constants to be determined. And for that purpose, you will need 2n number of equations in terms of Ai and Bi, so that you can solve the system and can find out. Remember, these plans are defined in such a way that this will have, the system you are getting from here will have a unique solution. So that will be possible to find out the solution with the help of the matrices which you already know. Now, second kind of spline is the quadratic spline. Quadratic spline is similar to this one with some addition. Addition is, this is another term we are adding to the linear spline. And if you simplify this one, this is a quadratic expression. Again, it's defined between two consecutive points, xj and xj plus 1. The value of j starting from 0 reaches up to n minus 1 as usual. But this time you can see you're having aj, bj and cj. The value of j starting from 0 reaches up to n minus 1. So it tells you when you are using the quadratic spline, so there will be 3n number of unknowns. And when 3n number of unknowns, then you have to solve a system of 3n by 3n number of equations in terms of aj, bj and cj. So remember, when you are increasing the polynomial, degree of polynomial, so it means that the number of constants will be increasing. If you look at this one, the condition will be just on the continuity of the function, the SHJ, I will say. There will be continuity condition. I will be discussing this later on, that how you can deal with this continuity condition. If you look at the quadratic spline, so if you look at the linear spline, when I take the derivative, I will be getting a constant. That's the reason we are not imposing the condition on the first order derivative. But in this case, if I take the derivative of this function, so I will be getting the first order derivative will be in terms of x, because when you do the differentiation, this will become 0, this will become bj, but this will become 2cj into x minus xj. X is there, you can impose the condition. So in this case, the condition of continuity which I was talking about, that will be on the function sj of x, as well as on its derivative. And when we apply these conditions, we can get the required number of equations. But remember, there will be shortage of two equations in both the cases. And then we will be covering by the boundary conditions. We will be applying the boundary conditions at the endpoints. So there are different cases, and I will be discussing it later on. Another kind of spline is the cubic spline. Again, we are having an extra term. And you can see the same spline with an extra term. So you can see there is a cube. So that's the reason it is called cubic spline. Now, if you take first derivative, x square will be there. In other words, I say x will be there, and we can play with that x. And if we take the second order derivative, x will be there. And in case of the third order derivative, this will become a constant. That's the reason we are not imposing the condition on the third derivative of the function. But we are saying that SHG of x, its derivative, its second order derivative, they will be continuous. They will be continuous at the contact points. So if you look at this one, aj, bj, cj, dj, the value of j is starting from 0 reaches up to, and in all the cases we are having a number of splines. And if you count j starting from 0 up to n minus 1, so you can see n number of constants coming from here, n number of constants coming from here, n number of constants coming from here, and n number of constants are coming from here. In other words, I can say that there are 4n number of unknowns to be determined. So you need 4n number of equations. Impose the condition of continuity on S, S prime, and S double prime. And that will give you 4n minus 2 number of linear equations. Plus two conditions coming from the boundary. So you will be getting 4n number of conditions. And 4n number, 4n number of equations. And of course, I told you that these lines are considered in such a way that the system of equations you are getting, that will have a unique solution. So that is possible to find out a unique solution, and you can construct this line. Another kind of, if I proceed further, that is quartic spline. Again, let's add another term. You can see the same spline plus an extra term. And you can see here the power of x is 4. This is called quartic spline. And again, this quartic spline is defined on the interval, the same interval, xj and xj plus 1. Now you can see aj, bj, cj, dj, and ej. These are constants to be determined. So if you look at this system, there are 5n number of unknowns to be determined. And if you take the first order derivative, second order derivative, third order derivative, these derivatives will involve x. X is a variable and you can play with that. So there will be condition of continuity on S in its first order derivative, second order derivative, and third order derivative. But if you take the fourth order derivative, that will become constant. We can't impose condition on that. And when you use the conditions of continuity, you can get a system of 5n minus 2 number of equations. Two conditions will be coming from the boundaries, and that will give you 5n number of equations. So initially from the condition 5n minus 2 equations, two conditions from the boundary, for 5n number of equations you will be getting. And again, that will be possible to find out this unique solution for this plant. Similarly, you can increase the degree, you can go up pentic and sextic and so on. So when you are increasing the degree, of course, the number of unknowns will be increasing and your calculation will be increasing further. Now let's go further. In your course, we are dealing with the cubic splines only. So, in a similar fashion, let's define the cubic spline. I say, as I told you previously, f is the function defined on this interval. And this interval has been divided into subintervals. N number of subintervals. Then the cubic spline for the function f is undefined as follows, having the following properties. Cubic spline S of x is defined by, as I told you before, that this is defined in this way. I am going up to x minus xj raised to the power 3. Since I will have n plus 1 number of data points, as I discussed in the previous slide, so there will be n number of splines. If you count, I'm starting from 0 reaching up to n minus 1, so there are n number of splines. S naught is between x naught f of x naught and x1 f of x1. Spline S2 is between x1 f of x1 and x2 f of x2. And finally, Sn minus 1 is the spline between xn minus 1 f of xn minus 1 and xn f of xn. In other words, I can say S0 is passing through the first two points of the data. S1 is passing through the second and third point of the data. And so on. So since this is cubic spline, so if you look at the spline AJ, BJ, CJ, and DJ, there are 4n number of constants to be determined. And that's the reason we need 4n number of equations. And as I told you earlier, that there should be condition on the spline S, its first order derivative and its second order derivative. Let's see what the conditions are. I told you S0 is between x0 f of x0 and x1 f of x1. So it will be passing through these two points. It will be passing through these two points. So if you look at this condition, S0 passing through x0, I should get f of x0. S1 passing through x1, I should get f of x1 when I replace x by x1. S2 passing through x2, f of x2, when I replace x by x2, I should get f of x2, and so on. Similarly, Sn minus 1 is passing through xn minus 1 f of xn minus 1. So when I replace x by xn minus 1, I should get f of xn minus 1. So you can see that in every subinterval, I talked about the initial point in every subinterval. And if you count them, you are getting n number of equations. J is equal to 0, J is equal to 1, J is equal to n minus 1. So this condition gives you n number of equations. You can see that every spline is passing through. If it passes through x naught, it is passing through x1, f of x1 also. That will be covering in the next condition. But if you look at the final spline, Sn minus 1, which is between Xn and Xn minus 1, so it passes through Xn also. So when we replace J by n minus 1, so I'm getting Sn minus 1 Xn is equal to f of Xn. So you can see that Xn and f of Xn, that is the point given to us. So one condition equation is coming from here. So from this condition, we got n plus 1 number of equations. N plus 1 number of equation. As I told you earlier, that there should be another condition. Condition of continuity. So you can see, S0 is passing through x1 and x0 and f of x0, x1, f of x1. And S1 is passing through x1, f of x1, and x2, f of x2. So you can see that x1, f of x1 is the common point. And the spline, any first spline is naught and the second spline is 1. Both are passing through these two points. But since I say this is a, this should be continuous. If it is continuous, so is naught at x1 gives me f of x1. And s f s a 8x1 gives me f of x1. S0 8x1 gives me f of x0. And S1 at the point x1 gives me f of x1. So both coincides. So you can see that that's the condition common. That's the condition of continuity. That is the condition of continuity. Similarly, if you look at this line S1, it passes through x2 f of x2. But S3 is S2 is passing through x3 f of x3 also. And S3 is passing through x3 f of x3 and x4 f of x4. So you can see that S2 and S3 coincide at the point x3. That's the reason this condition has been imposed. This is coming from the condition. This is the left hand side and that's the right hand side. And that's coming from the condition of continuity, which you people already know. The value of j is starting from 0 up to n minus 2. Why? If you look at your data point, this is the initial point and this is the final point. When I replace j is equal to 0, I am getting x1. So x0 is not the common point. That's why I'm starting from x1. So that's the reason when we replace j is equal to 0, I'm getting x1. Similarly, if I replace this j by n minus 2, I'm getting xn minus 1 from here. Xn minus 1 and Sn minus 1. Sn minus 1 is the last spline. But if I look at xn, if I replace here in minus 1, I will be getting xn. So remember, xn is the last point. I can't say that this there are two splines and both the splines passes through xn. So I will say this is the boundary point and x0 is the boundary point. So these are can't be the common points. That's the reason this condition has been imposed in the interior points. Interior points are starting from x1 and reaches up to xn minus 1. And if you count these, you can see that there are n minus 1 number of equations coming from here. N plus 1 number of equations, n minus 1 number of equations. So you can see that you cover, you are getting 2n number of equations from these two conditions. As I told you before, first order derivative and second order derivative should be continuous at the interior points. So you can see that this is the condition on. As I told you, that the two consecutive splines should coincide at the interior points. Similarly, their first order derivative should coincide at the interior points in similar fashion. Okay, j starting from 0 reaches up to n minus 2. It tells you that there are n minus 1 number of equations coming from here. I can't say this is n minus 1 because this will be xn. And xn is the boundary point. This is not the interior point. So n minus 1 equations are coming from here. And if we come towards the second order derivative, second order derivative also coincide at the interior points starting from x1 and reaching up to xn minus 1. Again, j starting from 0 up to n minus 2. So you can see you are getting n minus 1 equations from here, n minus 1 equations from here, n minus 1 equations from here. So I can say 3n minus 3 number of equations from these three conditions and n plus 1 number of equations from the first condition. So overall, you are getting 4n minus 2 number of equations. Two equations are remaining. in order to complete our system. For this purpose, what we are doing? We are playing with the boundaries, data points, x naught f of x naught and xn f of xn. These are the boundary points of your data. So there are two sets of boundary conditions. One is called the natural or free boundary. So remember, this has been defined, predefined. That's first order derivative of the first spline. First spline is between x0 f of x0 and x1 f of x. That passes through the initial point. So the conditions say that second order derivative at the initial point should be zero. And similarly, Sn minus 1 is the last spline which passes through Xn. That's the reason we are saying that the last spline, this is not X0, this is Xn. Sorry, this is Xn. So what I will say, last spline passing through the endpoint Xn, and that is equal to zero. So if I go for this one, so I will say this is a x. So these are the conditions, and two equations are coming from there. Straightforward that you can differentiate, you can find out first order derivative, you can find out the second order derivative. So two conditions are coming from here. 4 and minus 2 equations from here, 2 equations from here, and you got 4n number of equations, and then you can find out the solution. There is another type which is called the claimed boundary conditions. Claimed boundary conditions. Again, they are defining in the boundary. So the first line is S0 passing through the initial point. Since there, that should be, sorry, this is the derivative of the function. This is the derivative of the function which is given. So you can see now, these are the given conditions should be known, and this should be known at the final boundary. Again, if you look at this condition and this condition, two equations are coming from here. So if you are playing with the claimed boundary conditions, 4 and minus 2 equations from here, 2 equations from here, and your system is complete. So there are 4n number of equations, and you can find out their solution. You can find out their solution, and yes, you did that. Some points I will be discussing later on. Let me discuss this graphically. Try to understand, try to listen to me very carefully, and when you understand the graphical discussion, so I'm sure that there will be no problem and you can deal with these plans without knowing these conditions. Let me play with the cubic splines. I told you that there are n plus 1 number of data points. So if I have x-axis and if I have y-axis, and this is x-axis, that is y-axis. You can see it over here. The data points are given to x0, x1, x2, and so on. So I will say that this is the origin. X0, x1, x2, so on, up to xj, xj plus 1, xj plus 2, so on, up to xn minus 2, xn minus 1, and xn. So what I did, this is my E is equal to x naught and xn is equal to x naught is equal to A and xn is equal to B. So these are the subintervals along the horizontal axis. Let's look at the point. This is x naught, f of x naught. Another data point, another one, another one, another one, another one, and so these are my data points. Whatever the source is, we collected these data points. Now let's say coordinates of this point x naught, y naught, coordinates of this point x1, y1, coordinates of this point x2, y2, and so on. Coordinates of this point is x j, y j, coordinates of this point x j plus 1, y j plus 1, coordinates of this point, coordinates of this point, coordinates of this point, and coordinates of this point. So you can see that these are the data points. My target is to replace this data by a continuous curve, smooth and continuous curve. So what we are doing? We are defining the splines between two consecutive points in this way, as I discussed before. So let me define a spline between first these two points, and let's assume this is the spline between these two splines, and let me denote this by S naught. So this is the spline, so replace J by 0. You are getting S naught is equal to A naught plus B naught into X minus X naught plus C naught into X minus X naught square plus D naught into X minus X naught cube. This is the value of this S naught, expression for this S naught. Similarly, a spline between these two, let's assume this is the spline. So that will be when I replace J by 1. Let me represent this by S1. So you can see A1 plus B1 into X minus X1 plus C1 into X minus X1 square plus B1 into X minus X1 cube. And that's the spline between these two. This is just a curve I have plotted. It depends upon whenever you are getting a final curve. And similarly, let's continue. Finally, if I come to this one, the spline between these two I have defined by this curve, and let me represent this by SJ corresponding to this J. So J exactly like this one, between these two splines, the splines, let's replace J by J plus 1. So this is the curve, and I represented that spline by SJ plus 1. Continue it. And finally, I have a spline between these two points, xn minus 2, yn minus 2, and xn minus 1, yn minus 1. This is the spline between these two points, and let me represent this by sn minus 2, corresponding to this point. Sorry, this is 2. This is not 1. This is correct. This is n minus 1. And the spline between these two is defined by this curve. And let me represent this spline by Sn. So it means that J is equal to, this will be Sn minus 1. This is the spline Sn minus 1. So you can see that we have defined a spline between two consecutive, and you can see now S0, S1, Sj, Sj plus 1, Sj minus 2, Sn minus 1. We are having n number of splines for the data which is given to us. Now, if you look at your graph, this is the initial point of your interval, and this is the final point of your interval. So I can say that these are the boundary points. I will be dealing with these boundary points later on. Initially, as I told you before, this curve should be continuous. So this should pass through this point. To S naught at x1 is the same as S1 at x1. Similarly, S1 at x2 is the same as S2 at x2. And if you look at this one, this is the condition which you are getting. Initially, I say S0 passes through this point, S1 passes through this initial point, S2 passes through this point, and Sn minus 1 passes through this point. So that's the condition you are getting, the condition, the equations which you are getting from here. And similarly, I'm not discussing this passes through this point, but that will cover in next condition. Similarly, this passes through this point, that will cover in the next condition. But this line passes through this point, this is not common point. So that's the reason I'm putting the restriction that Sn minus 1 passes through Xn and you are getting Yn. Yn is equal to f of Xn. So that's the condition coming from here. So you can see that condition passes through this first one, this is two, passes through this one, this passes through this one, and similarly this passes through this one. So if you count them, 1, 2, up to n minus 1, starting from 0, reaching up to n minus 1, so you are getting n number of equations from here. And finally, when this passes through this point, so another equation is coming from here. And that was the first condition which I discussed before. These points, the blue points, you can see that these are the interior points of your data. And the red points, they are the boundary points of your data. As I told you before, that your splines should be continuous, their derivative should be continuous, and their second order derivative should be continuous. So if I say spline is continuous, S0 at x1 is the same as S1 at x1. Similarly, S1 at x2 is the same as S2 at x2. And that's the condition we are writing data. The two splines coincide at the common point. So this is the common point for S0 and X1. This is the common point for S1 and S2. And similarly, this is the common point for Sn minus 2 and Sn minus 1. And if you count these conditions, I'm starting from this common point, 1, 2, up to n minus 1. So there are n minus 2 number of equations you can see. Because when you replace j by n minus 2, you are getting Sn minus 1. This is the spline, and this point will become Xn minus 1. That is the common point. I think it should be clear now. Similarly, I told you that the first order derivative should coincide at the common points again. So you can see S0 prime coincide with S1 prime. 8x1. S1 prime coincide with S2 prime, 8x2. And this will continue. This spline and this spline, they coincide at this common point. And similarly, this spline, Sn minus 1, and this spline, they coincide at this common point. And that's the reason I'm going up to n minus 2. So again, if you replace n by j by n minus 2, you are getting Sn minus 1 prime. And that's the last spline. That's why we are not going further. So again, if the interior points, the blue points, the two consecutive splines derivative coincide with each other. And you are getting n minus 1 equations from here. Similarly, if you look at the second order derivative, as I told you that spline, first order derivative, second order derivative should be continuous. So again, S0 double prime coincide with S1 double prime at this common point. Similarly, S1 double prime coincide with S2 double prime at this common point. And this process will continue. This spline double derivative coincide with the double derivative of this spline at this common point. And similarly, The double order derivative of this line coincides with the double order derivative of this line at this common point. And that's the reason we are starting from 0 and reaches up to n minus 2. Again, if you look at the look at this number, when I replace j by n minus 2, I'm getting as n minus 1, and that is your last line. But if you see n minus 1, so this will become Sn. And remember, we have not defined Sn. So if you, again, if you count n plus 1 number of equations, n minus 1 number of equations, n minus 1 number of equations. So you can see that you are getting 4 n minus 2 number of equations. Number of unknowns are 4n. So two equations are required. So let's deal with this boundary. Free boundary conditions. Free boundary conditions. S naught passes through this point. So second order derivative at this point should be equal to 0. This is the first condition. Again, this is a mistake. This is Xn. This is not n. This is Sn. So you can see now here that this spline passes through this point, and second order derivative at this point should be equal to 0. Remember, this is the condition of the free boundary splines, free or natural spline. That's the condition. And similarly, this spline passes through this point. That's why we say that its second order derivative at this point should be equal to 0. These are the conditions of your natural or free boundary splines. If your problem is about the claimed boundary conditions, the claimed boundary conditions, so you have to ignore these conditions. You have to drop them. You have to use these two conditions. Again, S naught, first order derivative at X naught should be equal to first order derivative of the first order derivative of the function first order derivative of the function at x naught. So what I'm seeing now, okay, first order derivative of this spline at x naught coincide with first order derivative of the function, this function at x naught. And similarly, first order derivative of this last spline Sn minus 1 at Xn should coincide with the first order derivative of the function at Xn. So if you're having claimed splines, so you have to use these two conditions. A free boundary, yeah, naturally, you have to use these two conditions. And if you are using these two conditions, so you complete the system. If you are using two equations are coming from here, and that complete your system. So remember this rough curve, and then talk about the continuity of this spline, their first order derivative, their second order derivative at the interior points, and the conditions at the boundary. You will be getting a system of 4n number of 4n equations. And these will be the spline. Now look at it. For example, your target is to find out the value of the function somewhere here. Then replace x by that value which lies between x naught and x1 and S naught spline. And that will be your approximated value. That is your interpolation. Similarly, if you are looking for the value of the function between x1 and x2, so replace x by that value in S1. And similarly, if you are looking for the value between these two points, so replace x by that value in Sj. And if you are looking for the value between these two points, so replace x by that value in Sn minus 1. and that will be your interpolation. So this is the graphical discussion of the cubic splines. Similarly, if you are having quartic splines, you can discuss accordingly, but remember there will be another condition, and the condition will be on the third order derivative of the function. In case of linear spline, you will be dealing with the continuity only of the function. You can't play with the derivative of first order derivative. In case of quadratic spline, this condition, and the condition on the first order derivative. In case of cubic spline, condition in second derivative also. In case of quartic, condition on third, and similarly you can proceed further. So this is all about the cubic splines, and I'm sure that if you listen to me very carefully, so you can understand the concept of the cubic splines, your concept of the splines, and you can apply this technique to study your problem, your project, and hopefully that will be very fruitful. Again, I told you that it's important, it is using for the solution of partial differential equation, for solution of the differential equations, and you can deal with them. And these are important. If whatever the field of engineering you have, everywhere there are ordinary differential equations and partial differential equations, and your target is to find out their solution. So this technique can help you, but remember this I discussed just for the data points. For partial differential equations, you have to deal accordingly. Try to understand it. Listen to all the lectures, because whenever the institution opens, in the first 2 weeks, you will have your final examinations. That depends upon when the institution opens. That depends upon the government. Whenever they open the institution, so remember, you will have the examinations in your institution. Good luck. Thank you very much.